Hi, my name is Laura Greer, and I am a travel adventure writer and photographer, and also a blogger for Huffington Post. I wanted to be able to be part of the Talk to Me project with my mother because I haven't really ever had a candid conversation like this with my mom. And now that she's the time, because she's recently retired, she is sitting down and answering all of these questions for the Talk to Me project. So I want to introduce my mother.
My name is Isabel Blankmeyer. And I am the fortunate mother of Laura Greer.
What is the hardest challenge you think you've faced in your life? And I know that's a really rough question because you're a survivor and you know your family escaped Cuba when you were really young and came to this country. So I can only imagine what you're going to talk about for this question.
Well, I feel like I had two major challenges in my life, not just one. If you were to ask me, leaving my native country at the age of 12 and coming to the U.S. without speaking the language, leaving all of my friends and relatives behind and starting from scratch and watching my parents try to make it was really tough for me. But I was younger and better prepared, perhaps, to face the changes. I truly believe that the hardest and most challenging thing in my life has been my divorce, because it was a very, very difficult and sad decision for me to make. I did not take it lightly. I consulted with my father, who was like my mentor and guide, spiritual guide, and after talking with my dad, I obtained his blessing, and it was then that I decided that I had to do this in order to attain my happiness.
But, you know, you and dad, I can't even remember you guys ever really fighting, and one thing that was so cool about your divorce, but that was positive about your divorce, was that you guys have remained friends, and we still do things as a nuclear family, we still do holidays together, even now, 30 years, you know, in my 30s, and you're still doing that. And you've never really spoken badly about each other. In fact, if I've ever vented to dad about you or vice versa, both of you stop us and won't let us say anything bad about each other, which I've seen be the opposite for friends of mine who've gone through parents divorcing, and it can get ugly. So I think you just maintain like a respect between the two of you, which was made it really not that difficult. Like for us, the divorce wasn't that difficult for us.
And I sometimes think that the reason why you girls have an independent and resilient spirit is because you had to do so much on your own when you were so young in work. And that maybe made you who you are right now. And I'm so proud of each and every one of you.
Thank you. Let's switch topics to something more positive. What would be like happiest experiences of your life?
I have had many happy experiences, as you can imagine. I have wonderful memories of my childhood with my dad and my mom and my family in Cuba. I have wonderful memories when you were young. But two memories really stand out. And one is the day that we left our native country and when my dad stepped foot inside the plane. And he was safe, and our family was able to leave Cuba as a family. And that was one of the happiest moments I've ever had when I saw my dad inside the plane, you know, taking off together. And the other moments that I've had have been very, very unique and moving. But every time that I had you girls as newborn babies and I held you in my arms for the first time, it's like nothing else I've ever experienced.
It's funny that your happiest moments literally have to do with like being around a family member.
Yes.
It's not stuff or no. Like an actual adventure or something that you had.
No, adventures are a different compartment in my life, but after having lost everything that my parents own and I own and any legacy that they might have been able to leave me, to me what really matters is family and the bond that you have with all of the family members. But I think that the legacy that I would like my grandchildren to have is I want to ensure that my grandchildren are exposed to different things in life. That is, to the arts, whether it's graphic arts or painting and music, dancing, anything that is art related, and most important, for them to learn languages, foreign languages.
That's kind of a sore subject though with me, because you never really spoke Spanish at home with us.
I know, and I really, it's one of my life's regrets. There were reasons why I didn't do it at the time. I wish now that I had, but the grandchildren and your children can do it. I think you have all taken the time to study it and to learn about it, and you're communicating very well, even yourself, in your job.
Yeah, but it's frustrating for someone that loves to communicate in every way possible,
yes,
like talking and music and writing, and it's so frustrating with the amount of traveling that I do to not be able to just whip out a bunch of languages. There's something that you haven't ever told me, a story I've never heard, or anything that you'd like to share.
It is not a story per se, but it's how I feel about having you as my daughter. I feel that your life and your adventures has been incredible for me as a mother, and I feel very fortunate that you have included me in those adventures and have enriched my life in the process. And I also feel special that you have included me in your circle of friends. And
my posse of girlfriends.
Yes.
You're like one of the girls.
Exactly.
But I don't have any children, so you're not grandma yet when you hang out with me. I'm the only daughter that hasn't given you grandchildren. So
that's right. But
you're still one of the girls. Give me an example then of one of our adventures that I've brought you on.
Oh my gosh. The latest and best adventure ever was our joint trip to Bali.
Yeah.
Indonesia. It was one of my dreams, and the fact that you made it possible for me to have the scuba diving experience. It was one of those beautiful, surreal experiences I've had in my life.
So that's my mom's like bucket list, what she always wanted to do, because you're so big and love the ocean and the water, you wanted to scuba dive. And I just kind of had an epiphany in the last couple of years that I want to give experiences instead of gifts at Christmas, because I mean, you don't need any more stuff. And it's just so much better to have photos and memories. I mean, as a photographer, that's usually what I do. But I think being able to have adventures like that, and be able to have that for to even talk to your kids and grandkids about and how adventurous you are, is more valuable than a gift.
Exactly.
Going back to that trip to Bali, I'm really glad you were able to finally come on a trip with me. I know you weren't able to before you retired, but now that you have time to do that, you jumped on board and you're able to just like jump right in. I mean, the crazy adventures. We're on a plane and the pilot gets on the loudspeaker and says, the volcano's just erupted and we need to make an emergency landing in Lombok. We're like, Lombok? What's that? And it's like this Muslim island. It's not even anywhere near. It's like, and there's no way, everything's shut down for 24 hours. And I had to get to the photo shoot like
exactly.
The next day. The whole reason we were in Bali is to get to the photo shoot. So you were like, well, we really need to get in the customer service line and get a line. And I'm like, oh, no. We need to find someone with a boat. We're on an island. Someone has a boat. We're going to get that boat. We're going to go to the other island we need to get to. And so we're like, I'm just asking people, who's a boat? Who's a fast boat? And you're like, is this a reputable taxi company? I'm like, no, Mom. It doesn't work like that in Bali. We need to find a guy with a boat. So the guy's like, I know someone with a boat. And he's like zooming us through the island. We like get to his friend's boat. And there's no room on the boat. We have to climb on top of the roof of the boat with like a bunch of Australians with beer and like, hang on.
That's right.
And like, I'm like, we're going to get there.
But you forgot to mention, if I may say so, that our ride through the unfinished turnpike.
I like how she says turnpike.
Yes, okay, that's how they called it.
Not even a paved road through
right.
Like a village.
It was
an Indonesian island, okay?
But they called it the turnpike. It was a highway that had to be completed. So the man said to us, oh, we'll get you there fast. There'll be no other cars on the highway.
And you're like, I don't think this is a real road. And he's like, no traffic. And it was like, because it was an unfinished construction road. And at one point, we're hanging on to the top of the roof with a bunch of Australian stowaways, like beer. And I'm like, I look back and I'm wondering how you're handling it. And you're like, this is awesome.
And the city is flashing on me, the waves, and I'm feeling like, oh, this is the life.
Meanwhile, like, National Geographic's texting me like, so you're going to be at the shoot tomorrow, right? Like, yep, we're going to be there. And we got there.
And we made it.
Thank you, Mom, for taking the time to do this interview.
My pleasure. My
phenomenal. Thanks, ladies.
Thank you.